Our food is scanty, our clothes are of rough wool, our drink is water from the stream. Under our tired limbs is but a hard mat. When sleep is sweetest, a bell calls us to pray. There's no room for selfishness, no time for idleness. Everywhere there is peace, everywhere serenity, and a marvelous freedom from the noise and bustle of the world. These words were written over 800 years ago by a young monk called Aelred. He'd come across the wild North Yorkshire moors in search of work and to serve God. His search ended here in this remote valley. Below him were white-robed Cistercian monks, cutting wood in the forests, digging in the fields, and laying the foundations of a church. He spoke to them, and his mind became excited. He'd found a way to serve God. He remained and became a monk, and was eventually chosen as their leader, Aelred, the abbot of Rivo Abbey. Aelred discovered a new life, a life of stillness and peace. Away from this peaceful world, life was a harsh struggle for survival. It was a world of famine, plague, and war. People worked long and hard on the land. Even so, famine was rife. Life expectancy was short. People died from plague or were killed in wars. Abbeys belonged to this grim world, but separated from its turbulence. Abbeys rose majestically over the countryside, islands of civilization in a sea of ignorance. Rivo Abbey was far from this world of violence, corruption, and wickedness. So the monks devoted their lives to the service of God, free from distraction. They built this church, and in it they prayed for all mankind. The stillness and the beauty of Rivo remain. The Cistercians were pathfinders of civilization. They came to this wilderness, and through their labors they tamed the land, creating paradise and serving God and man. The monk was a servant of God, a man apart. He wore a special habit and shaved his head into a circular patch. The monk, then and now, obeyed what was called the rule. The rule was written by St. Benedict in the 4th century. It was simple. Every monk swears to live in poverty as Christ had done. He banishes women from his life and promises to submit himself, without question, to the will of his ruler, the abbot. This is the monastic rule: poverty, chastity, and obedience. Women, as well as men, could take the rule and become nuns. There were monks of war. They were knights who lived as monks and fought the enemies of God in crusades. The pagans lost, the Christians won. And he who would bow his knee and go to the font and a Christian be, they left him his life and goods to enjoy, to live in peace without annoy. But the pagan who still denied our Lord, they gave him death as his reward. Even today, there are holy wars. One order of monk knights survives, the Order of St. John of Jerusalem. It now runs a world-famous eye hospital in Jerusalem, ambulances, and first aid. The daily routine of the monk's life has also survived. In the Benedictine Abbey of Ampleforth, the pattern of life known to Aelred continues almost unchanged. Seven times a day, a bell calls the monks to church and prayer. It sounds first 2 hours after midnight for matins, the first service of the day. The monks walk in sandaled feet over cold tiles and file into the church for prayer and praise. The language is still Latin, the language of the medieval church. At Rivo, these same prayers were offered to God 800 years ago. They asked for mercy on the souls of all men, living and dead. Beyond the church are the cloisters. The monks walked here in silent thought. The cloisters also lead to other parts of the abbey. The monks gathered here to wash their hands before their meals. A lead tank was set on the shelf behind the trough, and the monks' towels were kept in a recess opposite. The monks had collections of books. Learning helped men to understand God and his creation. The best scholars were sometimes given leave by their abbot to continue their studies at a university, Oxford, Cambridge, or even Paris. These men returned to write books, works of scripture, philosophy, mathematics, astronomy, medicine, and science. History books were written by the monks, which gave an insight into their lives. There was no printing in the Middle Ages. Every book was copied by hand. Specialist monks skilled in writing copied books and decorated them with patterns and pictures. The finest books were embellished with gold leaf. Imagination and fantasy merged together on many pages. Since ignorance was considered an ally of the devil, it was the duty of all monks to study and teach. Monasteries contained schools. Here, monks taught boys and nuns girls. Small children learnt their alphabet from a hornbook. Then lessons moved on to writing and reading. Classes were conducted in Latin and began at an unearthly hour of 6 in the morning, when today's children are fast asleep. There was no mercy for the latecomer. John Hockleave, a 14th century schoolboy, recalled, "My master peppered my ass with good speed. He would not stop till it did bleed. Much sorrow may he have for the deed." It is a disciplined life for monks as well. The abbot was ruler and judge. In the chapter house, they came before him with their complaints. Sometimes spiteful, sometimes petty, sometimes serious. Brother Richard Stamford says that divine service is not performed in the church. Also, loose and suspect women have overmuch access to the abbey. He says also that Brother Thomas goes after breakfast and supper into the town and stays there, amusing himself with many persons, even women, until 10 o'clock. Even the abbot might be accused. I say that the young monks, when they should be corrected for their misbehaviors, murmur against the abbot. I say also that the abbot is defamed because he goes out of the abbey by night, having taken off his habit. Punishments varied. The guilty were given a strict diet or forced to say extra prayers. At St. Mary's Abbey in York, life had changed from the simple rules laid down by St. Benedict of poverty, chastity, and obedience. The monks were slothful, wining and dining, supported by rich patrons. Women were frequent visitors in the abbey, and the monks disobeyed the commands of their abbot. 13 of the monks rebelled against this worldly life and pleaded with Thurston, the Archbishop of York, for help. He gave them land 40 miles away to build a new abbey. This land was called Fountains, because it was, and still is, a place of running water. The rebel monks set to work. But they were not craftsmen. So, 6 monks were sent from a French abbey, and they provided money and skilled help in the building of the new abbey. The staple diet was a coarse, grainy loaf, which was chewed rather than eaten at breakfast, dinner, and supper. The main meal was at midday, a thick broth of vegetables, beans, and barley. The monks had their meals together in the refectory. They sat on long wooden benches before a plain table. Talking was banned. Hand signals were used to communicate. Waving palms meant more fish. Hand rubbed against the nose meant pass the mustard. The monks chewed away in silence. One monk would take a book, often the life of a saint, and read from this balcony. The monks' food was stored here in the cellars. A senior monk, the cellarer, managed the supplies and even sampled the stock. It was once filled with the smells of dried bacon, fish, cheese, and barrels of beer, ale. The basic food, rye, barley, wheat, beans, came from the abbey's estates. There was a bakehouse and a brewery, both staffed by servants and controlled by the cellarer. Meat was stored, but only kept for sick monks. They lingered in the infirmary on a diet of beef broth and chicken to build up their strength. Privacy was a luxury in the Middle Ages. The lavatories were open to the world. Water from the stream was cleverly diverted to wash away the waste. It's hardly surprising that the monks preferred ale to water. The only luxury in the abbey was reserved for the abbot's guests. The monks offered hospitality to all travellers who came to their gate. Many did. Pilgrims, great lords, knights riding to Parliament, and merchants about their business. They were well looked after, as befitted their rank and importance. In the guest house were warm fires and soft beds. The host, the abbot, offered spiced meats, rich sauces, and good French wine. Afterwards, there was music and entertainment. Guests paid nothing, but were expected to make some gift to the abbey on leaving. Most did. King John, who had pressed himself and his court of hundreds on the abbot of Bury St. Edmunds, left behind a stingy 13 pennies. The poor and the sick also came to the abbey's gates for food and clothing and money. It was the monk's duty to be charitable to all. At Mount Grace Abbey, only the poor passed through these gates. This was a Carthusian house, noted for its severity and strictness. Around the quadrangle were 24 cells, one for each brother. Each cell contained a room for sleeping with a mattress and blanket. Upstairs was a study where the day was spent reading holy books, meditation and prayer. The brother could walk into his small garden to contemplate God's creation, herbs, flowers. His food was plain and vegetarian. A platter of fruit, vegetables, and bread was placed by his door. It was very much a life of isolation, and the monks at Mount Grace only joined together to pray in this small, simple church, now in ruins. No monk has prayed here for over 400 years. What destroyed this simple life of dedication to God? What became of the monks? Why are the abbeys now in ruins? The story of the end of the abbeys begins here, amongst the tombs in Gloucester. It's a story of decay, envy, and greed. Edward II, unhappy King of England in the 14th century, murdered by having a red-hot poker thrust into his bowels. No sign here of his troubled reign and violent death, nor would one expect there to be. The Abbot of Gloucester, who buried him, hoped that the dead king would be made a saint by the Pope. The tomb would become a shrine, and pilgrims would come here to pray to the saint and offer money. It was a good idea. The nearby Abbey of Hales had a glass tube which contained the blood of Christ, or so it was said, and attracted a stream of pilgrims with money in their purses. But it failed. Poor Edward was not made a saint. The Abbot of Gloucester had failed. Gloucester found other sources of money. Rich men are buried here because they admired the monks and needed their prayers. It was a kind of insurance policy against the sufferings of hell. Good men and women gave their money, and it paid for a larger church with fine coloured windows and carved wooden stalls. These offered some comfort, for when raised, the misericords gave support to the monks' bottoms during those parts of the service in which they had to stand. Money came from other sources. The sheep, whose wool once made cloth for the monks, grew in numbers, and now the wool was sold in the marketplace. The richer abbots were now great landlords, who hired lawyers and bailiffs to run their estates. They lived in luxury with rich food and feather beds. All had servants, and a few even brought their families to share the comforts. Were such luxuries common to just a handful of rich abbots? Did their brothers still obey the rule? The 14th century poet Chaucer did not think so. One of his Canterbury pilgrims was a monk who had turned his back on the cloister and the rule. His head was bald and shone like a looking glass. So did his face, as if it had been greased. He was a fat and personable priest. He was not pale like a tormented soul. He liked a fat swan best, roasted whole. Greyhounds he had, as swift as birds, to course. Hunting a hare or riding at a fence was all his fun. He spared for no expense. This was written 40 years after the Black Death first swept across England. Many monks died, and more later when the plague returned. New recruits were hard to find, and most were unsuitable. The younger sons of rich families crowded into the abbeys and found the strict rules not to their taste. They wanted to keep old pleasures, and so hawks and hounds were kept in the cloisters. Pocket money was allowed to many monks, and there were plenty of ways to spend it. dice and card games were played, and women's laughter was heard more and more in the cloisters. Monks grew their hair long and aped the fashions of the rich. Many abbots lost control or didn't care. In nunneries, more and more nuns were the daughters of country squires who couldn't find husbands. They settled down to an easy life with their lapdogs and comforts. They had musicians to play for. At Stamford, one nun ran off with a harper from Newcastle and was never seen again. As they got richer, so religious zeal declined. In 1500, Abbot Hubie of Fountains built this great tower. On it he had carved the seals of the local knights and squires who had given money, and set his own initials, mitre and badge, on the tower. It showed a small falcon called a hobby, which was a pun on his name. The abbot was mindful of his duty, so he had carved near the top of the tower the words, "Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever and ever." When completed, the great tower looked down on an abbey which had vastly changed since the rebel monks had come from York 400 years before. The working monks, known as lay brothers, were no longer there. All the manual work was done by servants. These servants outnumbered the monks, for fewer men found themselves drawn to a monastic life. 400 years later, another traveller came to the abbey. He'd been sent by Henry VIII with orders to find out how the monks lived. Did they serve God soberly? Was the abbot a fair ruler, or were the rules ignored? Was the abbot a careless slattern, and were his monks disorderly drones? The king's visitor was handsomely entertained in the abbot's house. It was a prosperous place with huge profits from the fleeces. This was seen in the 100 servants who looked after 22 monks. No lean, hard men here worn with labour. Aelred and his brothers would have been dismayed by the soft life of his successors. The king's visitor was not impressed either. He expected better things of the monks. After all, were they not the servants of God? Were they not set aside by the rule? Or were they just like other men? If they were, then why did they enjoy such wealth? Questions like this were asked all over the country. Public opinion was turning against the monks. The king was at loggerheads with the church. He wished to divorce his wife, Catherine of Aragon, and marry Anne Boleyn, but the Pope stood in his way. Henry would not be thwarted. He created his own church to do as he wished. The Abbeys were among his first victims. They were suspected of loyalty to the Pope. Their lands would pay for the King's French wars. Henry moved quickly. Visitors were sent to the Abbeys to sniff out the weakness of the monks and the nuns. Their findings resulted in an Act of Parliament which dissolved all the smaller abbeys. Not everyone shared the views of Parliament. In the north, the people rose to uphold the abbeys which they loved. Their leader, Robert Aske, pleaded their case before King Henry. "Your Grace, the abbeys in these parts gave great alms to poor men and laudably served God. Now the churches of God are ruined, pulled down. The tombs of honourable and noble men destroyed, and no hospitality is kept in those places. No one was denied horse meat or man's mead, so that the people were greatly refreshed by these abbeys. They were one of the beauties of this realm to all men. But not for Henry. Ask was refused, and for his treason, he was hanged alive in a cage at York. His followers suffered on countless gallows in the north, among them many monks and abbots. King Henry's wish was obeyed. The small abbeys fell in 1536, and the larger ones 3 years later. There was no place for monks in Henry's new church. They left their abbeys with only a meager royal pension. The road to Riva. 1537 saw the end of the abbey and its monks. The pack horses and carts carried the abbey's gold, silver and jewels to London and King Henry's treasury. Behind them came the monks, driven out at the king's command. They looked back over a countryside which their predecessors had created from a wilderness, at a great church where royal servants were stripping lead from the roof. When they'd gone, local folk came and took the stones to build houses and repair walls. A generation later, William Shakespeare walked among ruins such as these. He remembered the scene in the lines, "Bare ruined choirs where once the sweet birds sang." The monks were the sweet birds who sang in praise of God. The picturesque ruins, all that remained of their community. All this would have been unthinkable to Aelred, who had seen the birth of the abbey and had seen its church rise up. Or would it? In the library, he would have read that only God is eternal, and that all things on earth have their time and their season before they pass away. Such thoughts may have crossed his mind as he walked in the cloisters. In their season, the monasteries had served God and mankind well. They'd advanced learning, and they'd guided and reserved civilization for 1,000 years.